this picture. Mr. Curtis Ray Perry wears a lot of hats, helps a lot of with the children's church and everything. Let's give this man a hand clap.
To worship Him with our songs, with our hearts open to Him this morning. Lord, we just praise You, Lord. We just thank You, Lord, who You are today and who You are through us, Lord.
Sovereign in the mountain air, with me at the dawn, with me at the dawn.
quite sure how things are going to come together. You're not sure where the money's going to come from. You're not sure how you're going to get through this issue, maybe that you're dealing with in a relationship. We're getting ready to present these things to God right now. Lord, we thank you, God. We thank you, Lord, that you are sovereign. Hallelujah, Lord. We have got the book of the Bible, Lord, this morning, oh God, which you have given us, oh God, and we have seen time and again from Genesis to Revelations, God, that you're sovereign, Lord, and that you're there, Lord, and you hold the answers, oh God, in this book, Lord. They're all right here, God. This is our manual, Lord. Hallelujah. And God, we present our lives to you this morning, oh God. We present that detail, God, that situation, oh God, where we do not hold the answer, God, as of yet. Oh, God, we don't understand how A and B are going to come together, God. But we place ourselves in your hands right now, God. It might be for a loved one, God, that we're presenting it to you right now. God, at your feet, oh God. We don't understand, oh God, how things are going to work out, God. We don't understand, oh God, but we don't have to, God. We go to the one, God, who is sovereign right now, and we lay it before your feet this morning, God, and we trust you. We trust you, oh God. Hallelujah. We trust you, God. We trust you with this situation, oh God. Hallelujah. Just as we trust you, God, with our life, oh God, and what you're doing, oh God. God, we can look back, oh God, and see, oh God, how you haven't left us, oh God, and how you haven't forsaken us, oh God, how you've been there, God. And I know, God, this is our story for the future, God, that you're going to be there, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. And we present these places, oh God, these situations to you this morning. God, and we instead of worrying about them and, God, and fretting about them, God, we're going to praise you, God, for how you're going to bring it all together, Lord. Hallelujah, God. We're going to trust you, and we're going to praise you, God, how you're going to bring the solution, oh God, how you're going to bring the provision, oh God. God, how the resolution is going to happen, Lord. We thank you, God, and we praise you, God, and we honor you, God, in this place, oh God, this morning, oh God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We set a marker on this morning, God, of the morning, Lord, where we lay this down, oh God. Hallelujah. And in days to come, God, we're going to testify, God, how you made it happen, oh God, how you laid it, oh God. Hallelujah. I see a road being laid out, hallelujah, God. God, for us to walk on, God. I pray, oh God, we would trust you, oh God. Hallelujah. We would trust you with this, oh God, and we would just walk step by step. As we step in the light, hallelujah, God, we're going to step by step by step by step, trusting you, God, waking up in the morning, praising you, honoring you, God, getting our eyes on you, God, and not on the situation, God, getting our eyes on you, God, worshiping you, Lord, hallelujah, getting our eyes on you, God, getting our focus, oh God, hallelujah, as we get our focus on you, Lord, and then we walk in this road step by step by step, hallelujah, God, you're going to be laying the bricks, and God, and just laying out, oh God, the solution, oh God, and we're going to look back, oh God, and we're going to marvel, oh God, and how you brought it together, hallelujah, hallelujah. But God, we didn't even realize how it was all coming together, God, because we're going to be worshiping you, and our eyes are going to be on you, God, and not on the situation, oh God. God, I pray, oh God, we will be people who will praise you, God, and worship you, God, hallelujah, and marvel, oh God, hallelujah, and be in awestruck wonder of who our God is, and who he is for us, hallelujah, God, hallelujah, God, not ones who will fret, oh God, and be anxious, oh God, and hallelujah, you tell us to be anxious for nothing, hallelujah, that is what you tell us in your word, oh God, hallelujah, we want to take you up on that this morning, Lord, hallelujah, by laying this down, whatever it is, hallelujah. It might be something personal. It might be for a family member. It might be for a coworker this morning. But we lay it down this morning. We say, worthy is the Lamb this morning. Worthy is the one that we worship. Worthy he is. Holy he is. And Lord, we sing a song to you this morning to worship you, Lord, as a church family.
Holy, holy is he. Sing a new song.
on the mercy seat this morning. Hallelujah.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is He. Sing a new song to Him who sits on heaven's mercy seat.
He's the same God as today. He is still on the throne. His son is on the right hand, and he's interceding for you, and he's interceding for me, and he wants nothing but my best to come forth. Hallelujah. He wants nothing but the best for me. Hallelujah. And this God, hallelujah, who brought down walls, hallelujah, and made small armies win, hallelujah, victory, hallelujah. The same Jesus who raised people from the dead and opened blind eyes, he's still the same this morning, hallelujah. And God, I pray for wonder to come back into the church. Awestruck wonder, God, to come back into the church. God, just that the mention of your name, oh God, hallelujah, hallelujah. It won't be casual anymore, Lord, hallelujah. It won't be just a name being called out, God, but I pray for the wonder, hallelujah. And I pray for the awestruck wonder of God, hallelujah. God, for the fear of God to come back into the church, hallelujah. Jesus, your name holds power this morning, oh God, hallelujah. You're living, hallelujah. You are flowing, oh God, hallelujah.
Breath and living water, such a marvelous mystery.
Sunday morning, I asked everybody to take a kind of a 3 deep breaths. How many remember that? I remember that? Yeah. Yeah, so I'm going to ask you to do the same thing for a much different reason today. But I'm going to ask you that you would take 3 real good deep breaths. Tension in the room. I thought it was just, you know, Pastor Roger even referenced that as well. But we just sang about a beautiful reality of the song of heaven. And you know, I'm not going to open up scripture, but much of what we sang about that last song is in Revelation. And I believe it's chapter 4, if I remember correctly. So I'd ask you to go and to do a little bit of reading in that book. It's such a privilege and such a good, atmosphere, if I can use that word. That's why I got you to breathe in. Because it says for us to pray God's will, right, on earth as it is in heaven. And that maybe it's just a small taste. Without further ado, I would like to invite Reverend Charles T. Davis, maybe better known to some as PC, but the facility director of our up at Prince George, the properties up at Prince George. I'm going to ask him if he would come, and his lovely bride, Miss Wendy. So I'll ask you to give him a round of applause as a big welcome.
Do that, but y'all preached it, sang it, shouted, prayed it. Jesus, you're all I need. Theologically, that's not absolutely. It's really, that's not right. Because God created us for one another. So all these people that you're sitting beside, they're part of God's gift to you. Isn't that amazing? Now I know we always don't agree, but God made us that way, right? And if we all agree, Wendy and I don't agree. No. After 31 years, going on 32. We don't agree. Sometimes the older we get, the sharper our disagreements are, but it's okay. Oh, the Lord is good. So good to see all of you here today. Those of you who are smiling and those of you that can't smile, maybe you'll get a chance to smile a little bit later today. But my privilege to share with you today a little bit from Jude, the book of Jude. Anyhow, we're going to start there. And, I'll have to keep my own time. It used to be a clock right there, back there. Brother Leonard, it is good to see you this morning, sir. Can you hear me okay? All right, very good. Hallelujah. Amen. Good to see all of you in the house. let me get my glasses here. Don't let the devil trick you into believing that you're not needed. Or that you don't need your neighbor or anyone in your family, because that's, again, part of God's plan. It's his gift to us. And how we treat one another is very, 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 very important. Several months ago, again, it was in January, I did take the time to watch the National Prayer Service after Donald Trump became, after his inauguration, and I was very careful to listen to the prayers. It was kind of neat there, and there was this gentleman that got up there to pray, and all of them were saying very, very short bits of prayers. Did anybody happen to catch that or watch that? The inauguration, that prayer service. But anyhow, the gentleman, he got up there, and he had a headdress on, and certain, you know, I don't know kind of what religion he was, but he made this statement. He said, "Now unto the God whom we cannot love unless we love others." I thought that was powerful. I think everybody in here might say, "Yeah, I love God." But now, if you caught that or not, we can't love God unless we love. That's supposed to be liberating. It might not be liberating. That could be a little bit tightening. I'm not sure. I've been praying all yesterday and prior to yesterday and on the way up here, Lord, make sure whatever I say is what you want me to say, because our time is short. And so what a preacher tries to do is he tries to communicate something that will affect eternity for you and possibly change the trajectory of your life. So that all of us, end up being and doing what God has called us to do. Anything outside of that, anything outside of what God has called us to do, and I know all of us are searching whether we've been serving the Lord for 3 hours or for 33 years, we're still searching after God and still trying to understand what all of that looks like, and we debate with ourselves as to whether we can do this or whether we can do that, and all these theological issues and all these social issues that are out there. How about we can pare it down and try to make it simple? If it's simple, it's a little easier to manage. Amen? Sometimes Christianity, it is complex. Oh, God. understand a man that was born supernaturally, he lived and then he died and then he rose again. Hallelujah. We're celebrating that right now. We're in the season of Lent. Easter's just around the corner. We celebrate the resurrection of the Lord. Amen. And how all that happens, and somehow that as we pray and we believe in Him, something supernaturally happens to us. Hallelujah. It's called being born again. And Jesus said, without being born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God. Woo! Isn't that exciting? Let me try to use my indoor voice. Isn't that exciting? Praise the Lord. Let's read some scripture here. Wendy, I need you to pray now. So, Wendy, you pray, girl. But I stay focused. All right. Jude. I'm going to start at verse 1 of Jude. Just a few verses here. Begins this way. Jude, the servant of Jesus Christ. What a great start. Amen? What a great start. Remember, we get to read the Bible, not just read the Bible. Jude, the servant of Jesus Christ and brother of James. Now, I've connected dots here. Jude is believed to be a half-brother of Jesus. Okay? That's what people who are way smarter than me tell me. That Jude was probably a half-brother of Jesus, meaning Mary was Jude's mother. He goes, it says, to them that are sanctified by God the Father, and preserved in Jesus Christ, and called, mercy unto you, and peace, and love be multiplied. Amen. That's just pretty words right there. That's verse 2. Verse 3. Beloved, when I gave all diligence to write unto you of the common salvation, it was needful for me to write unto you and to exhort you that ye should earnestly contend for the faith which was once delivered unto the saints. For there are certain men crept in unawares who were before of old ordained to this condemnation, ungodly men, turning the grace of our God into lasciviousness and denying the only Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ. Let's drop down to verse 17, please. A lot went on in between there, but I'm going to go here, verse 17. But, beloved, remember ye the words which were spoken before of the apostles of our Lord Jesus Christ, how that they told you there should be mockers in the last time, who should walk after their own ungodly lusts. These be they who separate themselves, sensual, having not the Spirit. Verse 20. But ye, beloved, we just love that. Building up yourselves on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. Verse 21 is the text that I'm trying to use today. Keep yourselves in the love of God. Looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ unto eternal life. Father, land the next few minutes that we have together as we're celebrating and worshiping you, Father, I pray, God, that you help me to say what is needed to make the maximum impact. Hallelujah. Are we able to put that scripture on the screen, you guys up there? Jude 21. Mm-hmm. Jude chapter 1, verse 21. That's so everybody can see it. In case they haven't seen it, I want everybody to see it. Because. So sometimes we live by sight rather than faith. Sometimes. Not all the time. Sometimes. Hallelujah. Verse 21. I guess I'll give it a minute. I'll read it again. I want you to remember these words. Remember, it's Jude 21, okay? There suggestion. We don't want to interpret this as a suggestion. We don't want to interpret this as a statement or an opinion. Right? Everybody with me? This is a command. Now I know in the 21st century, in 2017, a lot of us have trouble with commands because in the postmodern culture that we're living in, there's the assumption and the conclusion that there are no absolutes. That's the culture that we are living in, and the culture, you have a culture in your home, you have a culture here, every local church has a culture, and what attracts people is the culture, and actually the culture can actually trump vision, elders and leaders. Culture can trump vision. You can have a vision, and I commend you to plant a church. That's going to be awesome. Isn't it amazing that $5,000 can pay a pastor or minister's salary for a year, and plant a church, get a place to stay? That's amazing, is it not? What a glory of God. So I commend you on that. That's cool. Very cool. I think Johnny was itching to write that check for $5,000. That's why I was here from the Lord. I'm messing. I'm just joking.
It's a person that keeps, a guardian.
something I found that fits very well, and I liked it, and I put it in here, and here it is. A guardian is a person who looks after and is legally responsible for someone who is unable to manage their own affairs. And when I read that, I laughed. I said, that so describes me. I can't take care of my own self. I can't manage my own affairs. In fact, every time I try to manage my own affairs, I'll mess up. Anybody understanding what I'm trying to say? I've got a few nods here, huh? Especially in the light of spiritual things or the kingdom of God or church things or our life period. Now, we think that we can handle it. Moments to talk about this place, this person, this space even that the love of God, Jesus help me, creates. So to do that, I got some points, and I think I even got three D's. I don't know if we'll get through all of them, but let's talk about the love of God just a little bit. And number one, the love of God is demonstrative. Hallelujah. Or in other words, it demonstrates something. Right? You know, so there's a lot we can say, but for the sake of time, would anybody like to join me over at 1 Corinthians chapter 13? I'll do this so you'll give you time to get there. How's that? 1 Corinthians 13, you got to love these verses here. Love is demonstrative. So what does the love of God look like when it demonstrates itself? Right? The Apostle Paul writes there, and we have the word charity in the King James, other translations call it love. It's the Greek word agape. But Paul gives this amazing description of love. And right there at the beginning, he says, look, charity suffers long, or is that love is long suffering. So as we connect a couple of dots, we ask ourselves this question: am I keeping myself in a place where I'm patient? Jude says, keep yourself in the love of God. So how what is that going to look like? when I'm demonstrating this love? Well, let's take a patience test. Now, we can spend the rest of the afternoon, maybe next week, and all the rest of the month examining how patient we are. So maybe what the reality is, Jude is saying, keep yourself in the love of God. What happens is, I'm here on Sunday morning, I'm in the love of God, but soon this afternoon, I got one foot out and I got one foot in. Or maybe Monday morning, I don't have no foot in. I ain't got no feet in. Well, I can't say that. I think you got the point. How about this? When love is demonstrated, it's kind. Are you keeping yourself to where you're kind? I love Pastor Hans several months ago. He said, Christians are supposed to be kind. Amen. Amen. It's not difficult. It just might not be that easy. Amen. Husbands and wives have lots of practice in being kind to one another, right? Come on now. This, again, this side is a little more honest maybe this morning than this over here. I don't want to be kind. Jude, he's trying to help us. What? To keep us away from false teaching and corrupt lifestyles. Okay? It's very important. Look, it's extremely important. So this love that's demonstrated. So we could go right on down the line. I intended it to get there and go through all of these things here about not being prideful and not being easily provoked. Are we keeping ourselves in a place where we're not so easily provoked? Anyway, it's okay to get quiet some Sunday morning. It's okay. How about this part about thinking no evil? I think the other place is translated as not keeping account of the sins committed against us. Are we keeping ourselves in that place to where we just not keeping track, not keeping a tally? 1, 2, 3, 4, strike through, that's 5. Are we keeping ourselves in a place like that? And then we get down to verse 8, the first part of verse 8, where it says that love never fails, or another version says that love never quits. Keeping ourselves in the love of God, it's demonstrated by us not giving up. Can I say that again? Because and we are living in such a day and a time where we are getting bombarded by false teaching on the TV, on the radio, even on Chris. Wherever we go, the water cooler, school, work, wherever, we're hearing things that might not necessarily be sound doctrine. And then we see corrupt lifestyles and we're being told today, or maybe even forced to agree that it's acceptable. You hear what I'm saying? And then we become desensitized and all of that. And so this morning, I'm just going to remind us, as Jude, I want to remind you, remember to keep yourselves in the love of God. And so the love of God never fails. Amen. It keeps going. And like more than the Energizer Bunny, it keeps going and going. And like, I want to say like this, that the love of God is limitless. The love of God is limitless. However, we try to put limits on it. Unfortunately. For the sake of time, let me try to move through some of my say-so or my notes here. Folks, with the love of God, we can reach anybody, anywhere. No matter what they have done. No matter how far they think they are from God. With the love of God, we can reach anybody, anywhere. Some people, perhaps, they feel like that they have, and maybe you have encountered someone like this, maybe they have done so much that God cannot love them. There are people have that mindset. And perhaps they may take it a little bit further. They may even think that they do not deserve the love of God. Is this making sense to somebody this morning. But the love of God is limitless. The Bible tells us that in Romans chapter 5 verse 8 that while we were sinners, hey, see, this is a good place to get your little church dance on, if you have one, okay? It says, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. What does that mean? How can we say it in a different way? Jesus didn't die for people who deserved it. But somehow in our theology or how we think, how we process, how we think, that we, because of how our culture is, that if we work hard enough, we certainly deserve it. Right? That's how we be, Anthony, right? You know. How we, the harder we work, man, I deserve that. Well, we work hard and man, I'm going to take a day off because I what? I be. But when it comes to the love of God, that equation, it doesn't work that way, because God loves us because we didn't deserve it. Hallelujah. Yes. Jesus didn't die for people who deserved it. In fact, he died for people who did not understand his love. Jesus died for people who resisted his love. Jesus died for people who rejected his love, right? We're going to celebrate that 4 or 5 weeks when we talk about it. It should always be fresh, refresh in front of us. So let me make this statement to try to get to the end of my first point. That a follower of Christ then should never hold back the love of God from anyone. Because love is limitless. And Jude says, keep yourself in that love. Let that be a guard. Allow that to be a serve as a guardian to protect you and to defend you and to keep you. Hallelujah. Number two, hallelujah, the love of God is descriptive. We talked about that. Demonstrative, the love of God is descriptive. So let me run through this right here. The love of God is the person of God. The person of God is the presence of God. The presence of God is the power of God. The power of God is the victory of God. Hallelujah. Paul, but Jude says, keep yourselves in the love of God. It is very descriptive. This is the place, to try to describe it a little bit more, is this is the place where the Holy Spirit of God is controlling us. Not us controlling us. Can I say that again? Because that's extremely important. And this, the love of God is being the descriptive, right? I'm going to make sure I'm on the right point. Yeah. Descriptive is that the love of God is where the Holy Spirit of God is controlling us. It's where He is moving us by the power of His Spirit. It's the place where we hear the voice of God. It's the place where we see God. And then from this place, this is where God, He sends us out with words and with actions to break darkness. Yes. Come on, folks. Yes. Why? What is love? What is love doing? Being descriptive and how what it is or what it's doing, it is the Holy Spirit infilling us and sending, then He's sending us up with words and actions that break darkness and in the result bring light and bring power and bring victory and bring restoration and all those wonderful things that we want to add on to that. So let me try to say this right here, folks. The most important thing then is keeping ourselves in the love of God, because that's where the Holy Spirit of God is taking control of us. And that is the only thing that's going to make a matter and make a difference in each and every person's life in here. Being filled with the Holy Spirit of God. If you are not full of the Holy Spirit of God, I want to encourage you, I want to challenge you to keep yourself in the love of God and see what God will do. Let me kind of want to say this way. I'm going to meddle a little bit, okay? I'm going to meddle a little bit because I understand it some. But you know, it's not our coffee bars in church do not save people. Nothing wrong with them. But our coffee bars and our small groups and all of the things that we do, that doesn't save us. It's only the power of the Holy Spirit of God that saves people and changes people. And if we begin to think or try to set something up to try to get people to get saved by bringing them and inviting them to our small group, that's not going to do it. It's only the power of God, the love of God, the power of the Holy Spirit that will change people and save people and Hall. Can I get somebody to celebrate Jesus with me right there? Instead of us being so hungry and so desirous of some of these other things that are going on in the world or even in the church world, how, why can't we be hungry and thirsting after the baptism of the Holy Spirit of God and being filled and being filled and being filled and being filled? Whatever happened to that theology? Whatever happened to that teaching? Whatever happened to that lifestyle? Whatever happened to that goal where people would come to a church and find themselves at an altar, bless God, or somewhere even in their bedroom, and that when the Holy Spirit of God just takes over, God, I want to love you. God, I want you to fill me with your love. And then after a time with Him, the Father gives you His gift.
Yes.
The Father gives you His gift. And when that happens, we cannot be the same. Can somebody say amen? We can't be the same. We can't, because we'll be filled with the love of God. And we just kind of looked at that in 1 Corinthians 13, how that's demonstrated. And now being descriptive here, what to do? He sends us forth to bring light. He sends us forth to bring help. He sends us forth to bring power, to bring darkness. Darkness is growing, folks. Darkness is getting darker, and it's getting darker. And we just don't want to get used to it, amen? We don't want to get used to the darkness, amen? We don't want to get used to the darkness, amen? Well, I just want to blend in. I don't want to stick out. I understand that. I understand some of that tension and that wrestling there. But folks, the Spirit, the love of God cannot be contained. The Spirit of God, it needs to get out. It needs to get out. It needs to get out. I see a lot of this. I'm translating that. I don't know if I remember that correctly. That means amen. Hallelujah. Number three, and I'm trying, I ain't doing too bad. Number three, the love of God is directive. Yes. It's demonstrative. It's, let me make sure, did I get it right? Yes, it's demonstrative, it's descriptive, and it's, I messed up, it's directive, or meaning it gives direction. Let me try to explain this, I will put it down here, maybe hopefully it'll come out right. The love of God is a place where God takes you out of your plans and puts you in His plans.
Yes.
That's good.
Yes.
Now we'll go kicking and screaming, but I'm going to say it again, all right? This is the love of God. Keep yourself in the love of God. It's demonstrative. That's it. That demonstrative. It is descriptive. Thank you. And it is directive. The direction that the love of God is that God takes us out of our plans and puts us in His plans. It's worth repeating. Because if we're going to keep ourselves in the love of God, this is what it's going to feel like, taste like, look like, son. That's where God takes us out of our plans. Wait a minute. I want to go to school. Nothing wrong going to school. I want to get a degree. Nothing wrong getting a degree. I want to get married. Nothing wrong getting married. I want to have my own business. Nothing wrong having my own business. But what if God's plans are different? To say it another way, folks, God brings a new order to our lives when He fills us with His love. Hallelujah. God brings us to a divine order into our lives. Now, I recognize